Welcome into game two of today's NCAA softball matchup between the Clemson Tigers and the Charlotte 49ers here in Clemson, South Carolina. Easton Smith alongside Scott Whitlock. Scott, just finished game one. It was exciting, and the Tigers did what they needed to do. They needed to win.
They found a way to win. We talked about that leading into game one, how this young Tiger program is finding ways to win. They just stretched a winning streak out to seven games. This is new territory for them. The game wasn't pretty at times, but they found a way to hang around, and win.
It was definitely impressive. A lot of different things going on. Let's take a look back. It all started with that Gambarda homer. Knocked it way past the berm. It was really impressive from her, and she does what she's been doing, and that's hit dingers.
Well, Gambarda carried the team in the first half of the game. You know, she supplied all the offense. She drove in both of the first two runs. There's an opposite field double right there. And it's just an absolute testament to the fight and the grit that the Tigers showed in that game. Because, like I said, at times it wasn't pretty.
Yeah, you're telling me. Gambarda, like you said, carried him a lot in the beginning of the game. And towards the end of the game, you see the bottom of the lineup here really coming in clutch and creating hits and creating runs so that the Tigers can get up to a 5-2 lead.
That was a two-out, two-run double. And that is huge.
And very impressive from them. And now we're going to see with Emma Whitfield on the mound what the Clemson offense can do and if they can continue to win.
Yeah, and with Pitt coming in here on Friday for three conference games, it's going to be huge if Whitfield can give them a good game today.
Whitfield, like I said, in the circle. And also, it's going to be interesting to see if they can get the rest of their bats heated up, like you said. Gambarda, the only player really in the top of the lineup to get anything going last game. ACC Player of the Week, Cagle, coming off a very hot week. And unfortunately just couldn't get things going in the previous game.
Yep, she had a tough game, but the one thing about it, she's too good a player for that to continue.
Certainly. So there's Camel, pitched a complete game.
She threw the ball more today than some pitchers throw in a week. She threw a lot of pitches, but she survived. She found a way, just like the entire team. She found a way.
And we'll see if Emma Whitfield can, the native from Dakota, Georgia, can give a performance that can match the Kamal performance of the one earlier today.
Yes, Emma is from just on the other side of the lake, as we talked about in the first broadcast, and I know that Coach John Rittman would love for her to give him a great effort here today. And she's 1-0. She's pitched 13 innings. She's appeared in seven games. This is only her second start. You know, and the opponents have hit 245 off of her. She does have 10 strikeouts, but she's given up 5 walks. And, it's just going to be really, really important that she give Clemson a chance to win the game, just like Cagle did. Gave them a chance to win, and they scratched up enough offense to do it.
Looks like the top of this lineup is going to remain the same for the Charlotte 49ers. Going to start off with number 21, Spencer Gray. Had a decent game last outing. And on deck will be Bailey Vinoy, their star hitter.
Yep. And they kind of held Vinoy at bay in game one. Both of the big hitters, Cagle and Vinoy, for the two respective teams, held it at bay. As you see Whitfield get ahead.
The great first pitch from Whitfield. So quickly, Whitfield's ahead at 0-1. Pitch to Gray. Going to be tipped and found back. 0-2.
Pitching ahead is everything. You know, we've talked about this and talked about this.
Here's 0-2. Got her to chase it high. Strike three.
What? You can't start much better than that.
1-2-3. And there's out number one there for Emma Whitfield.
Chase that one up. Oh, boy.
Nice play there by Emma. going to be the real test here, and it's going to be sent to the shortstop and thrown over.
Yeah.
6-3.
You know, and every time you get Vinoy out, you just kind of exhale a little bit, you know.
A sigh of relief.
This ball is hit sharply, but right at the shortstop, Goodwin, and she has no trouble throwing out the 49er catcher.
It was really going to be interesting to see how Emma handled Vinoy. First pitch, Vinoy comes out swinging, and it goes down easy, 6-3. Here comes Rochelle. Nice slow ball there, right down the middle for strike number one. Gets it right there on the outside corner. A little bit low. Rochelle batting 292. Takes the second pitch for a ball. Even count.
Yep. You can live with 1-1, but, you know, 2-0, 3-0, 3-1, that makes it tough on your pitcher.
She pops it high, right on the edge of the outfield, and just like that, 1-2-3 go the 49ers in the top of the first. Bottom of the first here in Clemson. A few changes in the starting lineup for the Tigers. Hyatt goes from 9th to 8th in the batting order, and then Oda slips in there as batter number 9. Got substituted in late in the game, game 1. And now she will be in the lineup in game 2. Maddox Hughes on the mound for the 49ers. Marysville, Ohio native. Yep. A right-hander. We'll see what she's got to bring to the circle.
She's got a 5.33 ERA and a 2-2 record. She's worked 22 and a third. She has appeared in 11 games and started 6 of them for the Niners.
First pitch to Pereira. Way outside for ball 1. We're at 293 right now. Runs up on it.
What a good inning that was for Whitfield.
A quick inning, and that's what you want.
Oh, man, you saw it done efficiently.
Here's the 1-1. Taking outside once again, 2-1. Speaking ERA-wise, her best pitcher was last game. It's knocked over to the third baseman. It's going to go off her wrist, and Pereira will reach first safely.
Well, the main thing is the base runner's on. It's only going to be a matter now whether they call that a hit or an error. That ball was hit rather sharply. I believe if the third baseman fields it cleanly, she does get the put out. We'll just have to see how the scores decide on it.
It'll be interesting to see. Meanwhile, Grace Matamor steps in the batter's box.
I would have called it an error, but that's just me.
First pitch inside.
And it goes as a hit. So I continue my streak.
That's why they're on the field and we're up here, right?
Yeah. Oh, I think we just had an illegal pitch call there by the first base umpire.
Wow.
David Bush. That's going to make the count. 1 ball, no strikes.
Yep. So now 1-0 the count to Matamor. Going to take this one low for a strike. 1-1.
Matamor's job is really simple. Move the runner here. One base would be great. Two bases would be even better.
Flip it. Go right behind her and off for a foul.
Tell you what, you got to tip your hat to JoJo Hyatt and Bailey Vinoy catching doubleheaders. I mean, it's not uncommon, but it's still grueling.
This is certainly not a fun time. Nice little pitch down the third base line. Tries to hustle over. But the throw will be in time for the first out.
But that was
the runner advances.
But that was a productive out.
That's right.
I mean, it don't go as a sacrifice, but it moved the runner. And now with only one out, and perhaps your best hitter stepping in the box, Cagle, Pereira's out there at second base in scoring position.
And that's what you want right now if you're the Tigers with Cagle in the batter's box. First pitch outside for ball one.
Yep. Looks like that the pitcher has good velocity on the ball.
Going to take it high for ball two.
I know that Hughes has an inflated ERA. It could be for lots of reasons, but velocity's not her problem.
Just got to maintain it inside the strike zone. Gets her to go at one on the third one.
She might have chased ball three.
Certainly close. Cagle went 0-for in game one. Trying to get something here in game two. 2-1 goes outside, ball three.
Yep. They're being careful with her. I would too. Sometimes when a hitter, like had a tough first game, she'll be too eager and you can take advantage of her. And but that time, Cagle showed great discipline and stayed away from it. And that's going to bring a visit out. That's going to bring a visit out by the head coach.
And look at this package from Gimbarda and what she's been able to do. There's the home run from last game that tied it up at two. Yeah. And she's going to be looking to do something here. Finally has some runners on base. Finally, when she was up, was the leadoff batter for two innings or so
during
last
the
game.
During the break, originally in game one, I'd said that home run was a two-iron hit out of here. I checked with Gimbarda, and it was actually she hit her three-iron.
Really?
Yes, she did. And she just stung it right out of here and probably closed the head down a little bit and just drove it right out of here. And now she steps up with runners out there on first and second. And I'm sure that while the 49ers met and talked about this situation, they were very mindful about Gimbarda and what she's capable of.
Gimbarda takes the first one 0-1. Now, did you speak to her caddy or did you speak to Gimbarda herself?
I talked to her directly.
Really?
Yeah, I find it bad fashion to put the caddies on the spot.
That's fair. Gimbarda pulls it just found on the third baseline.
What I really want to talk about that I have not had a chance to talk about is the move that Coach John Rittman made in that batter, in that third base coaching box when that ball was sizzled right by his noggin.
Now, that was some great reaction time by him. Oh,
like a cat. I mean, just like a cat.
Like he hasn't aged today.
No.
Well,
no,
looking like a college kid out here.
An old cat. No, it's an old cat.
0-2 to Gimbarda. Going to pop it up, and it's going to go into the stands.
Right below us. Somebody's got to make a play down there.
Looked right on the concourse. Nobody wanted to piece of that one.
They got to call that thing down there.
Lucky fan going home with a souvenir.
Oh, that's great.
0-2 goes just outside.
Yeah, that's a tough pitch to take.
Man.
You'll see. She just misses. That is a tough pitch to take.
She wanted that corner, too.
Yes, she did. That was a fine pitch. I mean, if you can back it up with something.
1-2, and she gets a hold of it. It's high. It's deep. It's gone. It is gone. Home run number 10 for Gimbarda. And just like that, the Tigers take a 3-0 lead.
The 49ers are thinking that was a foul ball.
Bit of controversy here. It looks right on the line. We'll see how the judges rule it.
I don't know if what's going on here we're going to see, but you can see that.
Let's take a second look at it. Man, she really got I wonder what she was using for that one.
That was a solid wedge or a nine iron.
Yeah, well, I think we're going to get a second look at it here.
The official, they're
going to come in here on the infield and have a discussion about it.
The replay from our angle is very inconclusive.
So there is no replay in softball. So from what I'm hearing, this is going to stand no matter what.
Well, no, they can reverse it, but there is no.
Okay.
It's going to be a home run.
They're going to call it a home run. So 3-0 Clemson on a controversial home run from Gimbarda, a home run nonetheless, and she is now the sole leader in home runs on the team.
And she's got a bucket load of RBI today.
That's right.
She's got at least five.
She is raking them in. Now, Cagle going into the day, Cagle was fourth in the country with 9 home runs. It'll be interesting to see how much Gimbarda goes up to with those two today. Officials still talking this over. Originally, they went back. They ruled it a home run, but now they're continuing to talk about it.
Let's see what we got here now.
See what Coach Rittman's reaction to this conversation is.
There's a chance that Gimbarda may be called out for passing the lead runner at first base.
Wow.
Now, what I don't know is, does that force a dead ball situation, and does Cagle have to go back on base? Let's see. So I think what we're going to have is a two-run homer.
With Gimbarda getting out?
With Gimbarda out on
the
play. And here's what I don't know. I've been doing this for 35 years. I don't know. I'm assuming the home run stands.
You would think so.
Statistically speaking. What we got? Okay, to run it first is declared out, and we got a two-run homer.
Okay, so does that make the lead runner or the...
I do not know. I honestly do not know how to score that.
So what they're saying is, I think they're saying that Cagle got out on the play, and okay, so
yeah.
Gimbarda with a two-run home run. I believe Cagle
is declared out.
Yep, because she went back towards first base as Gimbarda was passing her.
Okay.
So. Wow, we're being told the baseball game had the exact same ruling on Sunday. I've never seen that before.
Well,
that's incredible.
That is. Yeah, that's got me scrambled.
So anyway, Hannah Goodwin, after all of that, lines it straight to the shortstop and gets us out of the bottom of the first. But not before Gimbarda launches another one out, and it's 2-0 Tigers. Top of the second here in Clemson, South Carolina. 2-0 Tigers on what was a wacky play. Gimbarda knocks it out to left field, over the fence. It's ruled a home run. But then you see Lauren Cagle passes Gimbarda back to first base and is ruled out. And so what would have been a 3-run home run, which was originally argued by the 49ers to possibly not even be a home run, ended up being a 2-run home run and an out.
Yeah, that was weird. Now, the replay does give you and I clarification that there's no doubt Cagle did pass Gimbarda heading back to first base.
Here's Kruger in the batter's box. Trying to get something going. 1-1 to her. The Alpharetta, Georgia native.
Yeah, that's near me.
There you go. Not too far from Atlanta. 1-1 pitch. Right down the middle. Strike two. Zone is on.
Right here. That's a nice pitch on the inside part of the plate.
Solid arrow. Here's the 1-2 from Whitfield. It's going to be high and even up the count at 2-2.
If you look at Whitfield's numbers from high school, you will see that she is no stranger to pitching. I mean, she is. I know she kind of gets lost with the, with Kegel and whatnot. But Emma Whitfield, I mean, her high school stuff is just unbelievable.
And that last play was, last pitch was pretty pretty.
Yep. I was trying to look up and see if her bio contained it, but I don't think it does. But she won a lot of games at Stevens County High School. You see a hard liner foul.
Just on the wrong side of the base. It's a full count here to Kruger. Here's Whitfield. Pops it up, back. It's an empty seat to stay alive at 3-2. Tiger's still out and about today, signing some autographs. Here's a 3-2 pitch. Right down the middle, called strike three.
That was a nice pitch on the inside corner. You'll see right here. Watch this.
Oh, man. Oh, man.
That's better than a ham sandwich.
That's what you want.
I don't know, though. Honey baked ham's pretty good.
Ooh. Stop that right now. You're going to get me hungry.
Yeah, I'm going to have to retract what I just said. That was a very good strikeout.
Wright takes ball one in the dirt. Pitcher from last game. Had a very impressive.
She pitched
counting.
Pretty well.
She
yeah,
did.
She sure did.
She's going to take the second pitch all the way to right field. Gambarda's under it. And there's two away.
Yep. And the main thing that you're seeing Whitfield do now is she's throwing a lot of strikes. And strikes are good.
Taking control, too. 5 outs on 16 pitches isn't bad.
No.
Up steps DeVroe. She's going to send it high into the infield. Second baseman Pereira going to get under it and send us to break. So middle of the second, Tigers maintain a 2-0 lead. Lots of fans here at Clemson Softball Stadium getting ready to enjoy the bottom of the second.
Yeah.
Catching a few people off guard there. A
couple of stoic stares right there.
We've gotten here quickly off some great pitching from Emma Whitfield. But let's see if the Tigers can continue their offensive push. Had a great bottom of the first. A really weird call, but nonetheless, it's 2-0. And MK Bonamy looking to continue the streak. Going to take first pitch for a strike.
Maddox, she's up there in her second inning of work.
She's going to swing at it for strike two. And just missed it.
Yep.
Watch this right here.
Swings right through it.
Just early. Here's the 0-2. Outside for ball one.
You know, it's almost like just a basic rule of thumb. If it's 0-2 count, you waste a pitch, you throw a pitch way outside. My philosophy on that is beginning to change just a little bit. The hitters have gotten so good now, and their eyes are just so well trained now. I'm more about hammering the strike zone than I've ever been. Now, I don't believe in throwing anything fat and over the plate with 0-2 count, but I hate to waste, balls. I just really do.
That's a fact. Bonamy ready to get 1-2. One of the few seniors on this Clemson roster.
Yeah.
And the Hoover, Alabama native gets hit on the legs and will go to first base to lead off the bottom of the second.
Right here.
Just barely clipped. Looked like her shin almost.
Yeah, just kind of grazed her. It was not. It was not a flush hit by pitch.
So Mannix is having some struggles early on, controlling a few of her pitches, and it's led to some Clemson runs, and now a runner on first with nobody out.
Up, and there's
just
a wild
pitch. Just as I say that, into the dirt. And MK will advance to second. Yeah.
I love the music they play at this ballpark. I tell you, they are clever.
It is strategic, to say the least.
Very clever.
There's the pitch to Logaleo. She's going to bunt it, and she's going to get over safely. And MK stands at third base, and just like that, we've got runners on the corners with nobody out.
Nice job of bunting that time. She caught everybody flat-footed, and she put that ball down and just outran it. And you can see that she was clearly safe. You watch right here, and that's just a great job.
It's a great bunt by Legaleo. And now, the freshman JoJo Hyatt.
Yep.
The one who ended up giving Clemson some insurance in the first game is up with the runners on the corner and nobody out.
Had a big two-out double. You know, I'm still angry with you.
That's fine.
No,
that's fine. Hey,
you shouldn't bring my age up. You shouldn't bring my age up.
Gonna take first pitch strike.
Our listeners and viewers do not know what happens in between innings, and they're just a little hurtful.
Hey, I'm just bringing up some sports history.
Well, I know.
I can't help it.
I know.
Take pitch number 2 for a ball high.
I mean, the young Mr. Smith told a story that occurred that I remembered very clearly, as you see the stolen base right here.
Runner advancing easily to second base. And just like that, Clemson's got 2 in scoring position.
But Mr. Smith tells a story about an event that I remember clearly that happened before he was born. And he happened to mention that. And it just kind of disappointed me a little bit. But that's all right.
Man of sports history. I have to share my knowledge every once in a while. And,
well,
you know, it's just kind of coincidence. There's the 2-1. Tipped it into the catcher's mitt. All even at 2-2.
See right there.
Just missed it.
Didn't get it. Mm.
So JoJo Hyatt waiting on the 2-2 pitch.
And I'm sure John Ritten would love another double right here.
Slices it towards the netting on the right side. Mannix trying to find her groove. Gotta get somewhere around these Clemson hitters. Delivery just outside, full count.
Boy, Hyatt's done a good job of seeing pitches.
Full count.
Look out, John.
Pitch. Almost gets to Coach Rittman once again. That one was a bit more of a slow roller, but still.
Oh, yeah. Watch Johnny Ballgame show up and show his hops right here. A little move there.
He makes it look so casual, too.
Oh, he's just
a nice little step out of the way.
Free-flowing athlete, that is.
Here's the full count to JoJo Hyatt. Down and away, ball 4. Clemson loads him up.
Boy, that's not where you want to be. I can tell you that now. That's a very, very, very tough position to be in here now. You got bases loaded, nobody out, and you got the you got Oda coming up in the nine hole.
Ariel Oda didn't get a chance to hit last game, came on as a pinch runner. See if she can get anything going this time. That's the first pitch is a strike. She's batting 0-8-3 on the season. Has a couple RBIs. No home runs just yet.
I think they're aiming at him.
To the left. At this point, you would think so.
He's having to jump around a lot. Look at here. Here we go. Coming right at the camera.
Oh, man.
Freeze frame. Look at that. Beautiful.
Just barely misses our cameraman over there.
This is Otis' only 13th at bat on the year.
0-2 pitch. And way outside, 1-2.
It is tough to stay crisp when you get limited at bats. And so I know she's going to just relish every one of them that she gets here this afternoon.
Here's the 1-2. She wanted to pull on it, didn't.
Sure did.
Stayed home, and it was a good thing, too, because that was a ball, and it's 2-2. Yeah,
that ball was a little bit outside.
She was leaning. Here's Maddox to deliver the 2-2. Slices it back towards the netting. Stays alive at 2-2. Bases loaded. Nobody out. Bottom of the second. And Charlotte is in danger of digging themselves a real big hole here. And Oda takes ball three high.
Yes, base hit ball four if you're Oda. And Hughes is already finding herself in a huge moment in this ball game.
Outside, ball four. Tigers score a run and keep them loaded with nobody out. And this is not looking good right now for Charlotte.
I think this is going to be the end of the day for Maddox Hughes. I see that number 17, Carson Pace, is making her way out to the mound, and I think that's definitely what we're seeing here. So the 49ers are going to make a pitching change.
Yep. So Maddox's day will be done. Gave up three runs on three hits. And the 49ers have a brand new pitcher. So on the other side of the break, we'll introduce her. Get back to the action in the bottom of the second. New pitcher Carson Pace comes in for the 49ers, a Winston-Salem native, a sophomore, and she has been put in a very difficult situation with the bases loaded and nobody out.
Yep, she brings in a 4.27 ERA. She's 3-5 on the year. This will be her 17th appearance. She's worked 62 and a third innings.
And she's going to have to start off against the top of the order with Cammy Pereira.
Matter of fact, she leads all 49er pitchers in innings pitched by a wide margin.
First pitch away for ball one. 1-0, sent into left field, but right towards the left fielder. Clemson's going to tag up, and it's going to be 4-0 Tigers.
She hit it sharply, but out, but it was a sacrifice fly.
Right to Imani Rochelle.
Right, the run scores. Not much of a problem.
So now the Tigers with one out have runners on first and second. And Grace Matamor up to bat. 0 for 1 earlier. See what she can do now. First pitch high, ball one.
Up and in. Looks like to me Pace throws the ball very firmly. I don't know if she's regarded as their ace, but she's definitely their workhorse because she has, like I said, she's pitched 60-plus innings. And Her nearest teammate has only pitched 31.
There's the 1-0 pitch outside, 2-0. So Pace trying to limit the damage, get the 49ers out of this jam. 2-0 pitch goes high, though, and it's 3-0, and she's at danger of loading up again.
Oh, boy.
Gets the sign. Here comes a 3-0. Just on the top line for strike one, and it's going to be 3-1.
That might have been a bit generous.
Comes the 3-1. Pereira is going to be outside. And once again, the Tigers have the bases loaded. And Cagle comes back into the batter's box to try to put a dent in this score. Should I say another dent?
Yeah, well, she showed great patience her first at bat in drawing a walk. And I know she wants to get a hit and she wants to get off the snide.
Well, she takes the first pitch for a strike.
Yep. ACC Player of the Week. 3 home runs, 11 RBI last week.
Also pitched a 3-hit complete game, and just like that, she brings two more in for the Tigers, and it's 6-0. Right down the middle. Cagle, nice little grounder. Nobody was there, and the Tigers are up big.
Yep. What a difference a game makes. Last game was a struggle for both teams to score runs, and now the Tigers are trying to run away with this thing early. Still a lot of ball left to be played, but it's really hard work when you're trying to work from six down.
Yeah, well, it doesn't get any better for the 49ers because up steps Gimbarda. Two home runs so far on the day between the two games. And once again, she's got two runners on base. And we'll try to do some damage. Hopefully everybody stays in front of everybody else on the base pass this time.
Yeah, we need to stay organized out there, don't we?
Yep. Here's the 1-0. Slap. It's going to be sliced foul, the third line.
Yep, you'll see right here. Here's the home run from an inning ago.
Gimbarda starting us off on the scoring.
And it just blew its way out of the park.
Barely. Next pitch goes out wide for a ball. 2-1.
She's showing that she has all shots in the bag. Like I said, that was a nice wedge. And in the first game, she hit a 3-iron out of here.
Here comes the 2-1. Runners on first and second, one out. Nailed it. Left center field, that's gone again. She is not stopping today. It is her day. Gimbarda, third home run in two games.
She's not going to have to play any more this week, and she may be player of the week already. Three home runs in 9 innings of work. She's now got 6 or 7 RBI on the day. I don't even know anymore. But that ball was hit like a laser out of here.
Smoked it right past our cameraman in center field. My goodness.
And just like that, it is 9-0. And we're going to have another change, it appears.
49ers are not liking that, but man,
yep.
She sent that one to the moat.
So that's going to be Reagan Moore coming out to throw now. And Moore's stats are 3.82 ERA. She has no wins, no losses. She's appeared in 4 games, started 2, has only worked 3 2/3 innings on the year. So she's a rookie out of Lakeland, Florida. And right now her job is to just get some outs some way, somehow, and keep this somewhat respectable.
And the good news for her, depending on how you want to look at it, at least the bases are cleared. She's working with nobody on base.
She's one out.
So, you know, at least she's coming in with a
There's no pressure on her.
Start. Yeah.
There's no pressure on her.
Trying to do what she can. Get these last two outs and get us to the third inning. But it is all Tigers right now. 9-0, and we're still in the second.
Which ball do you think was hit harder, that ball we just saw or the ball in the first game?
You know, it's debatable. The first one went all the way past the berm.
Right.
And that's what impresses me.
Right.
But that one, I mean, that one was at least into the road over there, past center field. Cleared our cameraman's head.
Yep.
It's debatable. If that was a 9-iron, that looked like a driver almost.
Yeah, that ball was hit hard.
See our cameraman in center field. Give you some perspective on how hard that ball was hit. And Hannah Goodwin.
Is our cameraman even out there in center field?
Oh,
I can't see him.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, there's his hand. There we go.
So 0-1 to Goodwin. The freshman pitcher trying to get her team out of this second inning jam.
I'm being told that is cameraman Mike out there in center field.
Big shout out to our cameraman Mike out there.
Whoa!
Hannah steams it through right over the second baseline, right down the middle, and that's going to be good for another single.
And that's a bad feeling when you're a pitcher. That thing was sizzling as it went by her ankles.
Boy. I tell you what, you don't want to be hit by that. Ooh. Almost right in the thigh. That would have been a strawberry.
Yeah, that would have been a...
That's a bruise. In steps N.K. Bonamy. That's the first pitch for a ball.
And we've seen the Tigers do this a couple of times this year in scoring runs in droves. They have the ability to have big innings. And they have definitely blown this thing wide open.
Few examples you can think of is a big game against Maryland they had a few weekends back.
Yep, I had the privilege of calling that.
Was it 21-1?
No.
Somewhere close to that. Very early on in this season in this young program, it's been really impressive to see just how dominant they can get when they start running away with the game. Here's the 2-0.
I don't know if we had cameraman Mike out there should have field for that 21-run game, but the wind was blowing in that day, and it was so cold. Now, I don't know if he was working it or not, but
friend Mike.
Whoever was out there on that day, I guarantee they froze.
The 2-1. He's going to pull it deep. It's going to hit the corner of that berm we were talking about so much.
And you know, Easton, the thing is the most unfair about working cold games is our production leader, Santa Sub, is in a nice warm spot.
Oh, yeah. Our entire studio.
Oh, yeah.
Thankfully, we make sure our cameramen are bundled up well.
You know, and
as MK lines one out to the first baseman, and she gets the out cleanly.
We broadcasters have to sit out here and brave the elements and fight off everything, and they're sitting in there in their recliners and what have you.
I mean, you can't put too much credit towards us. We do have a roof under our heads, which is more than those cameramen can say.
No doubt about that.
A little bit. There you are.
Hey, there you are. Look
there
at
we
you.
Go. Got a roof under our heads. Logaleo steps up, hits one of the third basemen, and they are going to take care of it. 4-3 go the Tigers, but not before they put up a 7th spot in the bottom of the second. Taking a look at our excellent video staff there, Clemson Video. There's our camera woman, Khalees. We had cameraman Mike earlier, and there we got it over there.
Don't do that.
High first.
Yeah, don't do that. Don't grin that much.
Oh, me. Second pitch ripped to left field. Charlotte's getting something back. They've got something cooking. Just like that. Hawkins. Tessa Hawkins with the long single.
And that ball was hit sharply.
She squared up on that. Had it right down the third baseline.
But even hitting that ball sharply, I like the fact that Whitfield came in throwing strikes.
In comes Haley Webster to capitalize on that good hit. Slices it high and into the Clemson dugout.
Everybody has fun when you got a 9-run lead down there.
Here's the 0-1. Nailed her in the back of the leg.
Now that's what you don't want to do.
Well,
I mean, this right here is what makes pitching coaches grow old.
Man, that is not fun.
No, that was definitely a hit bats person.
Yep.
And, you know, you give your pitcher a 9-run lead, you've got to keep your concentration and approach this game as if it's 0-0. Your job's to get outs.
Corey Henderson takes the first pitch. High for a ball.
Yeah, that's what pitching coach Kyle Jamerson's on his way to the mound right now to tell her. Doggone it.
Got to make sure everybody's focused up. A 9-run lead is great, but it can make your mind wander a little bit and get you off to different things and get you focused on the next game, and that's not where you need to be right now because it's still the third inning.
You better believe it. This game is – I mean, they could score just as quickly as Clemson did, and they've got to keep your focus. You got to keep your wits about you. You got to play like you're tied. Everything's new.
And Charlotte quickly working with two runners on, with nobody out, and pops it up. It's playable for the third baseman. She'll get the first out.
See, that right there is a great example of the hitter helping the pitcher, because if I'm that hitter, I'm going to make her prove that she's going to throw strikes after what just occurred. But yet she's able to get the first out, and this is going to bring up the leadoff hitter, Spencer Gray. Well, 391 hitter.
And she's got options, too, with one out.
Yes, she does.
Here's the 1-0 pitch from Whitfield. Lifted high and out of play. Got a few chasers over there, a few kids with some gloves they brought to the ballpark.
Oh, yeah.
Here's the 1-1. High and inside for ball two. Yep. He's got two balls now.
What's he doing with all those balls out there?
Goodness gracious. Smacks it. Right center field. Center fielder going over. Gets the ball. They're going to try to... Looked like they were going to try to get the runner from second all the way to home, but she's going to stop at third. And Charlotte now has runners on the corners with two outs.
Yep. But a very, very, very dangerous hitter.
Here's Logaleo. Made the last catch.
In the box. They appealed that the runner left early at second base, but no avail. But this brings up Bailey Vinoy, and she on the season is hitting .475 with 10 homers.
Takes the first pitch low for a ball. Yeah, if Charlotte wanted to have anyone in this position, it'd be Vinoy.
Yeah,
she is dangerous.
And it is a good time to pitch to her when you've got a 9-run lead, but it's is not nearly as good when there's runners on base.
Swings at it for strike one. Chased it high.
She sure did.
So that'll even things up at 1-1 between Whitfield and Vinoy.
And
runners on the corners.
She's been eerily quiet today.
Vinoy will take it high for ball number two. Whitfield really didn't have a chance on the first go-around with Vinoy to duke it out with her. This one's going to be sent high and deep left center field. Back at the warning track, and Logalay is going to scoop that one up for the third out. So Clemson maintains the goose egg, and it's 9-0 in the middle of the third. Bottom of the third here, Clemson Softball Stadium. You see the fans there enjoying a 9-run Clemson lead.
Tiger making the rounds.
To start off the bottom of the third is freshman JoJo Hyatt. Reached on a base on balls in her first appearance. She's going to take the first one for a strike.
JoJo hit a two-run double in game one and immediately got moved up to the 8-hole from the 9-hole.
That's what you call moving up the ladder.
Oh, yeah.
Coach saw that hard work. Really was a clutch hit there in the first game.
That was a big hit. I mean, it gave him that cushion.
0-1, JoJo lifts it into center field, all the way back to the warning track. But Spencer Gray is there to make the grab. And there's one away.
She got a good swing on it, Chase Gray. What do we got here? Oh, we had an illegal pitch, so she's going to get a new life.
Okay.
And now we're going to have another discussion and another pitching change.
Now, explain to the viewers out there what made that pitch illegal. Tell me the.
I'll have to take a look at it closely to see. It may be that she is either leaping or if they can give me that last pitch. Let me see what happens here. Yeah, you saw her plant foot leave the ground.
Okay.
You can drag, but you can't hop. And it looked like that's what was going on, but no matter what, we've got a new pitcher.
Did she leave the game?
Yes.
From an ejection?
No. That was a substitution. That's a substitution. That was not an ejection. And that's number 27, Allison Green.
The senior from Riverside, California.
Yeah. She's 3-0 on the year. She's worked 19 innings. Got a 4.05 ERA. She has struck out 9, but has walked 5. And it looks like we're in a spot now where everybody may get a little work.
May as well at this point. It's kind of part of the duties of a doubleheader.
I think we played not quite 3 innings, and this is our 4th pitcher for 49ers.
49ers getting their pitching staff some work. And we'll see what the senior brings to the plate here. As JoJo Hyatt remains in the batter's box for the Tigers.
All right, we got things organized now. 2-0 is the count.
All squared up. Here's the pitch. First pitch from the senior is going to go out wide, and it's 3-0. So Charlotte in danger of walking yet another batter. That one's going to straight inside, make it 3-1.
That was a good pitch.
That was nice. Allison Green ready for the 3-1 pitch.
Foul straight back, but she's crawled herself back into this account. And we now have a 3-2 count. It's tough coming in and, you know, you inherit a 2-0 count. And you just really have no room for error. But she's done a nice job at least of getting back in the count.
And there goes JoJo Hyatt. Lifts it into the outfield, right and left center. And that's going to be a nice little blooper for a single.
Yeah, she's red hot. I mean, that's what happens when you get hot. The ball finds the hole.
Clemson bats heating up at just the right time. It may be a little bit chilly out here, Scott, but they are providing the heat.
The bats are staying warm for sure.
That's correct.
This is a...
Up next, Ariel Oda.
Good day of work right here for the Clemson Tigers.
Oda sends it out there.
They've got a big three-game series this weekend starting on Friday. The Pitt Panthers come to town for ACC action.
Clemson trying to remain at the top of the ACC.
I know I'll be here. Are you here? Are you here this weekend?
I will be here behind the scenes, but I will be here.
Okay.
Take that one low and inside. Strike zone. An 0-2, the count to Oda.
Umpires hate it when a pitcher throws a strike and the catcher drops the ball. That just makes them so aggravated.
0-2 down the right field line. That's going to be a base hit. Oda rounding first to second. They're going to send the runner home. Oda all the way to third base with a triple. And she's going to get the RBI, too. That's 10-0 Tigers on a base hit from Ariel Oda.
And you got to feel great for Oda because you got to remember, she's hitting 083. And she ripped that triple down into the right field corner.
I mean, you can't get any better.
And she was moving around that base path. Yep, and you... Watch her with her celebration move. Let's see, there's that, and
there
then there's
go.
That. I'm not sure what that means, but it's got to be important.
It's got to be positive, too, as Pereira steps yep. into the batter's box. Takes the first one, 1-0. Tigers with a runner on third, nobody out. And we're just in the third inning. Swing and a miss for strike number one. Pereira flew out to 7 in her last at-bat.
Took a big hack at that one.
Comes the 1-1. Goes outside. Ball 2. Looks for the sign. Here comes the 2-1. Into left center field. It's going to go right to the left fielder, but Oda is going to tag up and score, and it's 11-0 Tigers. So the runs keep coming for Clemson.
Goes a sack fly.
It was a great hit. Nice positioning. Just stayed up a little bit too much.
Yep, Pereira. She hit it just far enough.
Rochelle was able to get under it.
It benefited that Rochelle, being a left-hander, was running towards center field, and so she really had no chance to set and make a hard throw toward the plate. I don't think they could have got Oda anyway. She runs very, very well. And at the end of all of it, now the Tigers have an 11-run lead.
Up next, Grace Matamore, 0-for-1 on the day. Reached on a base on balls her last time up.
And you see, she's got that face paint on now. You see, if I'd have wore that as a pitcher, I would have probably been all conference.
Oh, definitely. That just adds to it.
Yeah.
That gives you a little spark.
Yeah. I gotta work on that.
Here's the 1-0. Pulls it, foul. Right behind Coach Rittman.
And we may need to start a movement to have Coach Rittman coach third with that paint on his face. I think that would be kind of...
See, that almost seems unfair for the other team.
But I just think it would be great. We're going to have to put that into discussion, Hopper.
I'm sure you can have a conversation with him about it.
Oh,
Pereira
I will. Yeah.
Pops it out, the second baseman. takes care of it for out number two.
See, the trick to doing it is to get to some of the players and have the players push it on him. He's not going to listen to me. He knows me too well.
You know your way around a softball team.
Oh, yeah.
So here comes Cagle. One for one on the day. Takes the first one inside for ball one. Clemson with the bases cleared now, but two more scored in the bottom of the third. And two outs. Here's the 1-0. Low and away, ball two.
Crowd still enthusiastic and still here. You know, a lot of times in a runaway, things get awful quiet, but not here.
Might be getting some trickle over from baseball.
Yeah.
They are also currently playing. Last time I checked, they were down 7-0 to the College of Charleston. Here's the 3-0. Cagle lifts it foul to the berm. 3-1.
Oh, yeah. You got to see the pre-swinging Cagle is always turned loose by Coach John Rittman, 3-0. Not a surprise.
The 3-1 right back to the pitcher. He's going to toss it over to the first baseman. And that is the inning. But the Tigers get two more runs on the board, and it is 11-0. Tigers. Top of the fourth inning. Clemson and Charlotte. The Tigers have an 11-0 lead on an offensive explosion here in the past couple of innings. And it's gonna take a lot. Let's see if Charlotte can start to chip away at it.
This is going to take a lot of chipping.
Well,
but you got to start somewhere, I suppose. But if you're Emma Whitfield, you've got to be out there knowing that you've got an opportunity now to put this thing away.
First pitch from Whitfield is going to be outside. Ball one. Rochelle back. Monty Rochelle, the left fielder, going to lead off for the 49ers. 1-0 in for strike one, and the count evens. Into the crowd once again, and we'll go to 1-2.
Well, we got to remember that this is a brand new program, and there's going to be ups and downs, but you've got to really, if you're Coach John Rittman, you got to feel good about the team's, just their attitude and the way they go about their work.
The best adjective I can use to describe this team so far has been fearless. They are after it every pitch, every at-bat, and they come at it with almost no care for what could go wrong.
I agree.
They just want to keep making it go right.
They compete.
And that one's sent to the shortstop. She's going to fire it over, but not in time. And Rochelle reaches on a leadoff single.
That was hit very, very softly. Want to mention that we got a new first baseman in the game. Kaya Keller is over at first base for the Tigers.
Here comes the sophomore Maggie Cannon. In her first appearance as well. Pinch hitter.
Keller wearing number 58.
0-1 goes inside for ball one. Count evens.
You want to throw strikes right now if you're Whitfield, you just want to pump them arms and pour strikes in.
One, one. She takes it. Swings at it for strike two. Take another look at this.
Yeah, we saw Cannon in game one take some big hacks.
Here's the 1-2. Waited on it, swing, went back, foul. Still 1-2. So with a runner on first and nobody out, here's Cannon. Big swing, strike three. Sit them down, Emma Whitfield. Another look at that.
Yep.
Keeps it low. Gets her to chase it. And she is one away here in the top of the fourth. Throws it over to second. Couldn't get there in time. On the strike from right. And Rochelle is all the way up to second base.
Yeah, that's a stolen base for Rochelle. I guess it doesn't hurt anything to run if you're 11 down.
Lifts it in the center field. A bit deep, but Logale is there. And she keeps the runner from advancing over from second base. So great heads-up play there by Logale.
That's going to bring up Devereaux, who had an eventful game one. She got hit in the ear while playing defense and took a pretty good gash.
An unintentional piercing to the ear.
Yeah.
And she gets that first pitch high for a ball. Didn't look good.
No.
The trainer was very concerned.
And it took a long time to get that under control. That was a real circumstance.
There's the 1-0. Lifted in the center field. Logaleo goes back once again, makes the catch, and the Tigers get out of the fourth unscathed once again. It's 11-0 Clemson. Man, if there's one thing Marissa Gambarda does, it's hit dingers. Three straight home runs today, and my goodness. And with those three home runs, she now leads the entire country with 11. She has been at work today.
Incredible. She has really found the Charlotte pitching to her liking, and she has just mashed it.
What a great day by her, and she's going to...
In fact, with that 11 home run, she now leads the NCAA in homers. And I know that Coach John Rittman is really pleased with what she's doing right now for this ball club.
Looks like they're going to take her out. The pinch hitter, number 13, Stewart. Said Coach Rittman said she had enough for today.
We're going to have to take the partners.
First pitch away, ball one. So Stewart steps in as a pinch hitter. Gambarda had herself a day. Thought she would give somebody else a chance. Here's the 1-0. Slices it back. Foul.
We've just been given a ruling that actually that was only 10 home runs from Gambarda because she technically was the runner that was called out for passing the base runner back earlier in the game. So she gets credit for a single and two RBIs, but no home run. So
wow.
Just to be sure everybody's clear on that, Gambarda now is at 10 home runs, not 11.
So she is, as soon as we give it to her, she has been temporarily taken off. It's going to be a pop-up out for Stewart. And out number one for the Tigers. So as soon as we give Gambarda the nation lead in home runs, it's going to be taken out from us by ruling, which is fair. By rule.
Well, there's not a lot we can do
about
it.
But you know, it is what it is.
Yeah.
Number six, Shannon steps in for the Tigers. Take the pitch outside for ball one. Carly Shannon, the freshman from Chester, South Carolina.
And I believe this is her first at-bat, if I'm not mistaken.
It is today.
I think it is for the season.
Really?
I'm looking at the stats that were provided, and I believe this is her first at-bat as a Tiger.
So Carly Shannon's first appearance at a Tiger starts off with a 1-1 count. And let's see if she can make the most of it. Green with the pitch. High for ball two.
Look at that dugout down there. I don't know if you can get a shot of the dugout. They are all about this at bat.
They are excited for their teammate.
That is great.
Pitch to Shannon. 2-1. Knocks it into her foot. County evens at 2-2.
There's a great backstory to Shannon. Shannon was not originally on the roster, but due to all the injuries that have occurred to Clemson there in the fall and early spring, Coach Rittman had to kind of reach out. As you see, ball three, kind of had to reach out and try to find some depth. And luckily for him and the Tigers, Carly Shannon was already enrolled and going to school here at Clemson. And that's how she came to become a Clemson Tiger softball player.
Full count to Shannon, knocks it back for a foul. Still 3-2.
And I guarantee you, her teammates really appreciate that because she comes out every day, she works, she pinch runs, she don't really get a lot of attention, does all the things that a teammate does. And now they're just all excited about her getting in at bat.
And it's nice to see all that work finally paying off for her, too. Yeah. Here's the 3-2 pitch. Man, slices just foul, and that bullpen is ready to explode if she can get something going here.
Yeah, if she hits a double, the dugout will fall down. They'll have to rebuild a new dugout.
Just built the brand-new facility, and the Tigers are getting so rowdy, it might have to be rebuilt real quick. Here's the 3-2. Just outside. It may not be a hit, but Shannon gets on base for her first at-bat as a Clemson Tiger.
She is aboard.
And they are about it. And so the Chester native.
And this is going to bring up Kaya Keller, who is... She is... 0-2 on the season. I think it's fabulous that Coach Rittman is clearing his bench and giving these youngsters an opportunity to play because they work hard.
A freshman from Hollywood, Alabama.
Hollywood.
Big time.
Yeah.
Second pitch she sees. She's going to go to the second baseman, and just like that, 4-6-3 go the Tigers in the bottom of the fourth.
Second out of the inning there.
She made it. Oh, okay. She made it safe?
Yeah, she reached first.
So they cut off the lead runner. Was able to just make it safe.
Yep. She just beat it.
Keller. It's a base hit on her first at-bat. Frank's going to take the first pitch for a strike.
Yeah.
In comes a new hitter. Again, Coach Rittman. Get more and more experience for these hitters.
And Frank doesn't have an official at bat on the year yet either.
There you go. Quickly 0-2 to her. Frank pulls it foul. Stays alive at 0-2. Here's the 0-2 pitch. Pops it back foul. So Frank, in her first at bat, staying alive.
Yeah. This has been some kind of inning.
Frank with the 0-2. She's going to take it inside for strike three. So the Tigers get some experience going. Nothing going here in the bottom of the fourth. And they'll go to the top of the fifth. 11-0. Top of the sixth here, or top of the fifth here. And let's take a look at what happened to the right fielder for Charlotte, Devereaux. Had a bit of a piercing unintentionally in game one. Ball hit her in the ear, knocked the earring through her ear, and created a hole, but they patched her up. They got her going, and she was able to finish out the game. And yep, you can see right there the Band-Aid on her left ear.
Got your basic Band-Aid on. Hit her so hard that it knocked the other earring into her nose.
Man, that's a bad day at the ballpark.
That's a tough blow right there, buddy.
Emma Whitfield will remain in the circle for the Tigers.
Now, here's what you're up against in Florida College softball. If you're up by 8 runs after 5 innings or 4.5 innings, the game is over. So if Emma Whitfield can go out there and get 3 outs before the 49ers score 4 runs in this inning, the game is over. Not to mention the fact that she's working on a 2-hit shutout.
And Tessa Hawkins, the third baseman for the 49ers, takes the first pitch strike. And Hawkins will pop that one into the net for a foul ball and strike number 2.
Tessa Hawkins. Good look at her there.
Here's the 0-2. She'll get a piece of it. Stay alive.
Staying alive.
Plenty of active fans here at Clemson. Here's the 0-2 pitch. Launches it foul.
Want to make the bullpen. See if that same young man goes down there and tries to get his third foul ball of the day.
That would be ambitious.
A little rascal.
Hey, the kid knows what he wants.
Yeah.
0-2 pitch from Whitfield. We go high. Bring the count to 1-2. One-two pitch. I'm going to take it to the shortstop. Scoops it. It's going to go just high. And Hawkins is in with a leadoff single for the 49ers.
Yep. The ball hit deep in the hole. Shortstop got away with it quickly, but she clearly beat it out. That's going to go as an infield single.
Been a little bit high from Hannah Goodwin, but nonetheless, a good play. Next pitch. High ball right to Goodwin. Give me the first out.
There's that first out in the fifth inning. There's a look at the Tiger shortstop.
Next up for the 49ers, number 4, Henderson. He's going to try to advance the runner. Going to take the first ball outside, 1-0. Whitfield only working on 53 pitches right now, too. She's going to slice it down the third base line.
And that's going to score a run all the way from first base. And Charlotte has one on the board. So strike off the shutout for the Tigers. A great hit there. And it's 11-1, Clemson.
Yep, she just turned on that thing. Looked a lot like the Hyatt double from game one. The base runner scored easily from first base on the play.
He just snugged it right on the inside of that third base line.
Yes, she
kept
did.
Kept it fair. And it had enough velocity to get all the way back to that back wall.
It brings up Spencer Gray.
Top of the lineup there for the 49ers. Gray tries to bunt. It's going to go foul for strike number one.
What you got to do, we saw Whitfield have this same problem after the big second inning, is you got to stay focused. We know the game's a blowout. We know the game is not in question, but you still have got to stay in the tunnel and do your work.
Second ball goes high. It's going to be 1-1.
There's a look at Emma.
One, one. Fouls it back.
Yeah.
So now Charlotte finally gets on board in this second game and has another runner in scoring position on second base with a chance to do more damage and force us to go to the bottom of the fifth.
Don't say that.
Gotta call it like I see him, you know? Spencer Gray with the 2-2. Here's the pitch from Whitfield. Lifts it over the head of the shortstop, and that's going to score one. And it's going to be an RBI single there for Spencer Gray. And it's 11-2 now for the 49ers.
And you've got Vannoy coming up to hit. And she does represent the run that would extend the game.
So Tigers in a dangerous position. Want to make sure that Whitfield is mentally ready. She's got two more outs. Keep calm, cool, and collected there. And in steps Bailey Vannoy. Going into the day, led Conference USA in four offensive categories. And she's going to look at the first pitch. And pop it right, dribble it right on the middle of the first baseline, and they're going to scoop it up easy for the second out.
Do you know how big an out that is?
That's huge.
If you're trying to get out of here in short order, that right there was huge. What a good job by Whitfield getting over there and fielding her position to get that out.
It's an incredible play by Whitfield.
You got their best player just to give you one.
Here comes Rochelle. Reached base on a single last inning. And she's going to try to keep this thing going. Two outs, runner on second. And she's going to look at it for strike number one.
That was a changeup. Watch here.
Oop. Nice little dip into the zone.
All I can do is stand there flat-footed and watch it go by.
Here's the 1-1 to Rochelle. High ball to the second baseman. Gets under it, and the Tigers take both games of this doubleheader against Charlotte. Incredible showing. It might not have been pretty the entire time. Might not have been perfect, but the Tigers extend their lead and go 2-0 on the day.
Yep. Great job if you're Clemson. Good performance by Emma Whitfield. Big time hitting, and the Clemson Tigers win a pair.
Great win by Whitfield. Tigers explode on offense. Gambarda adds a couple of homers between the two games. And you can't ask for anything better if you're a coach going into the weekend.
Nope, and if you're the Clemson Tigers, you just find ways to win. And they did that today. They got some work in. And next up is Pitt starting here on Friday afternoon.
That is correct.
So a long day. Clouds all up in the sky, but nothing but sunshine for Clemson offense as a pair of pitchers get their wins today. And the Tigers take both games of the doubleheader here at Clemson Softball Stadium. I'm Easton Smith alongside Scott Whitlock. And we will see you next time.